Welcome. I'm Debbie Kirkman with the Flight Safety Foundation. Safety is at the heart of everything we do, and we're excited about the innovations that NASA is exploring in the area of in-time, system-wide safety assurance. This research is recognizing that as air operations grow, especially those enabled by UAS and autonomous systems, that providing real-time analysis and mitigations to risk can make a significant difference in maintaining and improving overall system safety, both for those who are airborne as well as for people on the ground. NASA's work on an in-time aviation safety management system, or IASMS, is exploring the concept of a system that continuously monitors the national airspace system. And based on real-time data, as well as an understanding of risks, recommends or initiates safety mitigations to maintain an acceptable level of safety. It's also looking at how to incorporate new entrants, such as vehicles enabling urban air mobility, to understand how we can safely integrate these new air operations. Today's panelists are from NASA's System-Wide Safety Project. Dr. Misty Davis has degrees in mechanical and aerospace engineering. Her research is primarily about the mathematical modeling of complex systems, including systems in which people play a key part. Misty is an associate fellow for the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, and she has been featured as a woman of NASA. Next, Dr. Kyle Ellis is an aerospace research engineer at NASA Langley Research Center. He currently serves as the associate project manager for the System-Wide Safety Project under NASA's Airspace Operations and Safety Program. Kyle leads a team charged with developing an in-time aviation safety management system concept of operations that enables new aviation markets to exist and to protect those already in place, leveraging input from strategic partnerships across industry, academia, and government. John Coley is currently serving as the manager of NASA's System-Wide Safety Project. And prior to that, he was part of the agency's SmartNAS project management team. Before those assignments, John was on a detail to the FAA as the application lead for interval management in the Surveillance and Broadcast Services Program. He began his NASA career as a researcher at Langley Research Center and has served as the head of Projects and Advanced Concepts Branch and as the manager for the Next Gen Air Portal Project. Prior to joining NASA in 2000, Mr. Coley worked as the Airbus Fleet Specialist at US Airways in flight technical operations. John also served in the US Air Force as an aircraft commander and instructor pilot, and as the Chief of Space Software and Requirements Section at HQ USAF Space Command. Our fourth speaker today is Dr. Lance Prinzel. He has graduate degrees in both psychology and aeronautics. He's been with NASA for over 22 years and has published over 100 technical publications. Not only that, he's been awarded six patents on a wide variety of airspace safety topics. He currently serves as a senior technical advisor to NASA's System-Wide Safety Project. I'm thrilled to have these panelists here, and now I'm going to turn it over to our first speaker.
Hello, everyone. My name is John Coley, and I am the project manager for NASA's System-Wide Safety Project. The goal of the System-Wide Safety Project is really twofold. The first is to try to understand and explore the risks associated with the introduction of new vehicles, new concepts, and new operations into the national airspace system. The second part of the project is to try to understand and develop ways to mitigate those risks so that it, in the end, we have a system that is at least as safe and hopefully more safe than it is today. We believe that the overall way to achieve that is through what we refer to and what the National Academy referred to as an in-time aviation safety management system. Misty?
Thank you, John. So in 2017 into 2018, NASA asked the National Academies to review and provide recommendations to us about some concepts we had around in-time system-wide safety assurance and about how we could make sure that we maintain or even improve safety as we have new operations, new vehicles, entirely new ways of traveling airspace. That report is public. In fact, here is all the information that you could want to look this up yourself and read it. It's publicly available. It's downloadable at the short link shown on this slide. We certainly don't have time to go into all of the rich discussion that we do get into this document. But it's really important, I think, to pull out some key ideas. And the first is that this in-time aviation safety management system really has to continuously monitor the national airspace. And it has to be able to assess that data. And that can be second by second, it might be minute by minute, it might be hour by hour, it might be week by week. That's the idea behind in time, is that we need to be able to collect data in time to prevent whatever hazards that we're looking at. And then the other thing that we really need to be able to do is to understand not only the nominal performance of systems and the nominal performance of operators, but also to look at the historical data for the occurrence and the after effects of the off-nominal situations, and really to get a sense of what the resiliency or the fault tolerance is of the whole national airspace and its key elements. And we need to do that before we ever fly, of course, while we're flying, and again, after we're done. These safety assurance actions, they might take the form of recommendations, like we do today, to operators. And eventually, though, what we think will probably have to happen is that for some actions, we're going to have to be able to automatically take actions that prevent risks. And we do have a few cases where we do that today in the national airspace, but we think that's going to have to become much more widespread as all of these different operations become available into the airspace at very different levels of automation. And Kyle?
Sure, thanks, Missy. So kind of going into a little more detail, coming off of the recommendations from the National Academies and really how to implement in-time system-wide safety assurance and essentially transform the safety management systems that we have today to be able to incorporate, you know, emerging operations as we've envisioned them for the future, and to really advance the safety mechanisms we have in place for, you know, traditional commercial aviation and other parts of aviation we already have in existence today. We said, okay, let's take a look at the safety management system it is today. And as you see it laid out here, you see really four pillars to this. We took this from ICAO, has a really good document on this. I believe it's Annex 19. And we pulled this document and we said, okay, let's look at what we're doing today, evaluate what is happening now, and figure out what needs to change in order to realize, you know, all the different details of what Misty just talked about, to say, how do we actually do this more in a more in-time fashion and be a lot more, I'll say, quicker to react and even be proactive in some sense to be able to mitigate the risks and hazards that will exist in this, you know, airspace and national transportation system and worldwide transportation we see in aviation today. So all four are important: safety policy, risk management, safety assurance, and safety promotion. Where we really honed in on a lot of this was in the risk management and safety assurance, because if you look at a lot of the different processes that exist today, we collect a lot of data For example, we have FOCWA data, which is data that we look at from every single flight that's flying around, at least in the national airspace that we have today. And I know IATA has a repository for that worldwide. And that data is analyzed to identify, you know, risks and hazards that we may not be aware of yet, or ones that we are aware of, right? So we can pull that data to understand, you know, how many times have we had excessive bank angles, or how many times have we had missed approaches, and to start to identify different hazards that exist in operations today. And we can reallocate our resources to then adjust our risk management controls and set new safety performance standards. And that will inform the policies that are out there to set new broad safety objectives, and eventually assigns people who are responsible and accountable for enforcing these new, either a policy or a new safety assurance action that goes in to save this. And so, what if, though, we could actually take this and what the National Academies was suggesting, like Misty just eloquently laid out, was leverage technology to our advantage? Because if we can start to digitize this entire process and connect everything so we have a little bit better shared awareness and understanding, we can actually collect data, begin to fuse it together, and assess it in a way that allows us to identify hazards and risks in a much more rapid sense. And essentially what this would do by digitizing it and applying technology to this allows us to actually do this many times faster than we do today, right? We've seen processes like this with the Commercial Aviation Safety Team, for those of you who are aware of CAST. That process, the way that we do it today, can take weeks, months, years to implement new safety assurance actions. Whereas now, if we can start to leverage new digital processes that can do these six core functions we're talking about under risk management and safety assurance, we can actually begin to start doing things much more rapidly with an increased level of vigilance that just the human capacity just isn't even close to being able to do. So what that allows us to do is just to get a much better understanding of what's happening. And that's really what we mean by the vision of an in-time aviation safety management system, leveraging these new technologies to integrate all the data streams and to be able to assess them in a way in a much more rapid sense. And really, like I said, make the safety management system much more responsive and adaptable to, you know, ever-evolving operations. And that's really what allows us to achieve scale in operations, especially when we're talking about introducing new emergent markets like personal air vehicles and urban air mobility and small and large UAS. Because we hear people, you know, like the Amazons and Googles of the world, right, that want to do these types of operations, that introduces new chaos to the system that we need to be able to be responsive to and to create some order out of all of that. So this is where we focused our development of the concept of operations for an in-time aviation safety management system. And the core to all of that is these functions that I talked about with the digital technologies that we have, is they still need to be able to do this monitor, assess, and mitigate. And I want to talk a little bit more about what monitor, assess, mitigate means in terms of risk management and safety assurance. So we can go to the next slide, please. And this again comes from the National Academies, and this is what we've been charged with figuring out, how to actually implement and design prototypical systems that, you know, exhibit these monitor, assess, mitigate functions. And so really, if I go into a little more detail of what monitoring means, it's our ability to collect sensor and performance data of the vehicles, of the airspace, all the different agents in the system are new data sources. We need to be able to check that data for the quality of it, to be assured that it's actually true. We need to be able to fuse that data, and we need to be able to distribute it to the different entities, which we'll call services, functions, and capabilities that have this risk management safety assurance intent to it. And so we can distribute it to the necessary functions so that they can begin to make assessments. And assessments can take many different designs, right? We can model the flight planning data to see what it's going to look like in terms of third-party risk. We can begin to model flight performance data to see if there's any degradation in the vehicle operations themselves, look at conflicts in the airspace. And we can really just begin to make high-level assessments in all these, and we can begin to roll it up into a higher overall risk assessment for this as well, because, like I said, all these things are digitally connected. And we can mine safety databases, right? So the key to this is that it doesn't exist only in flight. It exists pre-flight. It exists post-flight. Because, again, we're making pre-flight decisions based off the data we have available to us, leveraging these new ISMS-type capabilities. We can use them in flight to be responsive and adapt to new considerations and constraints that come at us. You know, the known unknown hazards. The unknown unknown hazards, if we begin to make these capabilities much more capable to really, like I said, act in a way that aids the human operator that's inside of this. And if we mature these capabilities to a certain level, we'll actually begin to, on the mitigate side, handle some of these exceptions themselves. And so, like I said, these assessments will identify elevated risk based off the data that it sees and its a priori knowledge, and then actually begin to make informed mitigation decisions, right? And these are, again, time dependent. And eventually, once they've been matured to a certain point, you can begin to automate some of these actions to act in place of the human agent that's in there. So this is really what allows us to achieve scale. I'll pass it on to John for the next.
So here is an overview, or an operational view one, if you understand that language, of what a mission or an operation with an IASMS might look like. There's a lot of information here, and I'm not going to go over it in detail because you'll see it in the next slide. But there obviously is information that the vehicle will use before it even flies, during its pre-flight planning. That will all be a part of the IASMS. There will be opportunities to respond to emergencies. There will be times when new areas or restricted areas pop up, or traffic or birds that require a reroute. And that system will be able to understand all of that, manage all of that information, and approve the changes for this vehicle. So let's go ahead and go to the next slide. If a picture is worth a thousand words, a moving picture must be better. So here is sort of an example of what we saw in the previous slide. There's a vehicle that wants to go from downtown out to the airport, has a business executive that they're on their way. They've done their pre-flight planning and they have an approved route of flight. If you look off to the left, you might see some light red areas. Those are areas that they need to stay away from. They're obstacle clearance. And so the approved route of flight takes that into consideration. But now there's an emergency. Maybe it's a medical emergency. And the original mission of going to the airport has to be changed immediately. So the system recognizes that there is something has to happen, and the new route of flight from its existing position to the hospital is approved. The system is constantly providing information like where there are notifications of birds, or if there is a new restricted area that popped up, that the route of flight needs to be changed once again. And so that's approved. We also realize that there are rogue drone operations. And so one more time, the route of flight needs to be approved around that to stay safe. All during the flight, the vehicle is aware of alternate landing sites in case of emergency. It obviously wants to do things like avoid weather, and also wants to make sure that it avoids areas where there are known vehicle operations, even when they're approved. It'll be aware of VFR traffic and others, and you'll see that the hospital area has a red geofence around it. But because this vehicle is approved to go in there, the geofence is down, and the vehicle's approved to go in and land at the hospital and take the passenger to where they need to be. Next slide.
So what's really interesting, if you look at that, is there is the operation as envisioned for what we intended to do, and there are several systems and functions and pre-flight planning actions that need to take place. And we say, this is what we expect to happen. But as we all know, and we've all flown in the air transportation, and that it's still true today, things happen, right? There are new considerations that pop up. And these types of services are exactly what's supposed to address that. So to go into a little bit more detail of how these things are built, kind of the cookbook, if you will, is, like I mentioned, we are fusing different data sets together. So in our concept of operations thus far and working with industry to develop this, we've identified over 16 different vehicle and airspace and supplemental data service provider information classes that are needed really to start to build these different capabilities as we've envisioned them. So we're not just saying these capabilities exist at any one specific place. They are a distributed system of systems. There are capabilities that live on board the vehicle. There are capabilities that are in the airspace management, the air traffic management suppliers, right? Whether that's ATC, or it's, if you're familiar with the UTM concepts, the service suppliers that manage the airspace in a particular region. And they could even be a service in and of itself. So we're talking about a whole new market of industry-owned entities that provide weather data that's built by informed microclimate weather. There's new surveillance and ground infrastructure capabilities that are going to be needed, new messaging, third-party risk assessments that are needed at the hyper-local area. So say you're flying in New York City, there has to be information from the locality to know where people are to make sure that your flight plan isn't necessarily flying over that. And this is true for traditional airspace as well. We can bolster what exists today by beginning to fuse these different information classes to make new combined capabilities that just make us much more aware of the situations at hand and to be much more adaptive and responsive in a timely manner to the risks and hazards that can pop up, like we saw in that last video example we have. And the final thought about all this, really, in terms of how this plays into an overall IASMS, is that any one entity will have a particular set of what we're calling ISSA capabilities. It's the connection of all them together, right, to inform each other that really make up an overall IASMS. And that is the vehicle level, that is at the operator, say airline operations center level, and that's all the way up at what we'll call the nationally managed airspace system level itself, right? And the amount of information that needs to be exchanged between them is something that's still up for debate right now, right? Because we're not sharing just raw data from the vehicle. We're not trying to say that you need to share the raw, like, battery health data or fuel remaining data. We're saying that there is, between all these different entities and agents in the system, a certain requisite amount of information. And that's really what our concept of operations is looking to build upon by working with people like all of you to be able to help us inform what that system looks like, what information can and should be shared, and what information shouldn't be shared, because we also realize that there's a lot of privacy restrictions in all of this as well. So that's why this playing this into a bigger audience with all of you is a really helpful step in building this overall vision of an IASMS.
Kyle, I don't think you could have set me up any better. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, Misty.
So really, one of the things that the National Academies told us that we had to do right away was to develop a concept of operations and to really start to look at risk prioritization. Now, that initial CONOPS, our initial concept of operations, is out. We started with the UAM domain because we thought it was the tall pole. And you can find that. That's now publicly available at the link shown on the site. And unfortunately, looking at that, I can't decide if there's an extra underscore in there. I think there's an extra underscore in there, and that's not an open space. It's very unfortunate that you can't click on videos. So right now, what we are looking at is expanding that initial concept of operations that our team has been building to consider the broader set of operational domains in the NAS. So that's everything from traditional aviation to small intra-regional flights to package delivery to emergency response. That's really talking about the full scale of things. It includes classy airspace and the things we'll want to do with classy airspace, perhaps even commercial space. So it's really going to take us quite a while to have said that we've completely fleshed out the concept. Right now, we are, I think, very actively engaged with the airline industry. If you know about NASA's AAM ecosystem working groups, I would highly encourage almost anyone who's interested in this video to look at NARI, the NASA Aeronautics Research Institute AAM ecosystem working groups. That's a way that NASA is reaching out to all interested stakeholders to sort of have these broader conversations. It's completely free to you. So please sign up and attend and participate. We do have a very active collaboration with the FAA. So NASA and the FAA have what's called a research transition team. And in particular, we have a working group focused just even on the IASMS CONOPS, and then several working groups together in their own IA, in its own IASMS umbrella to sort of facilitate conversation about how this would need to move forward. We've also started participation with NBAA. The safety committee has an SMS ad hoc committee, and we engaged there as we start to think about transitioning from our current concept of safety management system to this broader, hopefully much more flexible and much more capable in time aviation safety management system that enables these new operations that we'd like to validate and make possible. With that, I am happy to take any questions and thank you very much.
So thank you all, and perhaps we can just have our slides turned off so that we can see all of the panelists now. Fantastic, thank you very much. Really some fantastic work you all described. I have a few questions for you all, and I think I'd like to address the first one to Kyle. And you talked about groups such as the Commercial Aviation Safety Team. I'm wondering what other precursors do you see to the IASMS, and how do you see these precursors evolving to this future system?
Yes, absolutely. I would say, you know, CAST is a very large organizational one, right? It's a group of many organizations, I would say, and rulemaking bodies and policymakers and all that. So that's why it was just a really good high-level example. I would say every organization that does any type of flight operation has its own safety management system that's there today. Follows a pretty similar model. And I would say we have a lot of really great systems in place now, right? So I use CAST as an example because we looked at loss of control in flight before as a leading cause of aviation fatalities. And I think they've done a fantastic job at assessing the data to figure out what the causal factors of all of that were and to actually put together some safety enhancements around all of that, right? It was a very formalized methodology for how they did it. And they implemented new policy changes and, you know, I'd say even, you know, investment changes to how they would actually address those different causal factors. And that's all based on research. What you'll notice in all that, and if there's any other analog to the organizational structures about how, say, an airline manages little hazards and risks that it identifies either in its organization or in its operations that it sees from the airline operations center or what it gets back from ASRS data, right? Our aviation safety reporting system. We get a lot of information back that's really useful to us in all that. What is the heavily involved thing in that system, though, is still the human being, right? We still have to be able to assess a lot of that data. We have to analyze it in a way that's not necessarily as timely as we need it to be to achieve scale. As we're talking about introducing new emerging markets that have, you know, 10 to 100 times more vehicles flying in a shared airspace, it kind of boggles your mind of the types of ASRS reports and all the data that would be flowing in for that. And it would exceed that. So there's a lot of systems in place today that we're simply just talking about augmenting and adapting into this, like I said, more digital architecture that we have for all that so that we can actually deploy new technologies that are at our fingertips here that we can actually mature to be more responsive to these things in a much more timely manner. I think Misty said it really well, like a lot of these things we see now happen in the months to years timeframe because a lot of times there are design changes in here. So addressing operational risks, you know, takes a while. I think pilots do a fantastic job right now, right? They are a fantastic precursor and they're a huge part in the SMS that we see right now. They are the adaptive agents in the system, right? I mean, John Kohling, our project manager, is a fighter pilot. He is a very highly trained pilot that is licensed to do what he does, and he is trained very well to be able to handle unknown unknowns, right? We see situations that pop up that we're not necessarily trained to do, but we have expertise that allows us to take in multiple sets of information and to make informed decisions to mitigate the risks and hazards. What we're really talking about now is that's a very timely action. We need to be able to essentially replicate what John is able to do and deploy that so that we don't necessarily have to have that level of human involvement with everything. And I think that's the key that's enabled by digitizing a lot of the data information sharing so that we can have shared intent, shared objectives, and to be able to, like I said, create order out of that chaos because you have, you know, millions of agents operating within the airspace. And so we have a lot of analogs right now for what exists. We're just trying to bring in the next evolution of what this looks like by you know, assisting the pilots and eventually being able to actually leverage technology in a way that allows us to really to start to distribute the way these things are managed.
And so just to follow up, what I also inferred is that you're talking about machine learning, perhaps even artificial intelligence, doing some of the things that we have in manual processes today.
Yes. Yep. I think that's a key piece to it, right? So if you look at monitor, assess, and mitigate, if that's what we're saying is the core functionality behind risk management and safety assurance, a lot of that's done by people today, like in the examples we said. And like I said, they are the adaptive agent in the system. We need to be able to adapt. We need to be able to have flexibility. I believe somebody once coined the term that flexibility is the key to air superiority, right? We need to be able to have the systems in place that can do that because it's very expensive and it is very difficult to be able to distribute that many people to be able to do something, especially when you have larger and larger sets of data. So luckily we have machine learning and artificial intelligence that can start to ingest all this data, do it in a very fast manner. It learns from itself, which is great. So it can look at the hysteresis of a battery performance or vehicle performance and start to see how things change over time. And it can take that new data in and make new informed decisions on how it needs to react. And I think that really is the synthesis of what we need this all to do, right? Is to actually be able to ingest that data, make good assessments on it, and actually adapt in a more in-time fashion. Mm.
Thank you. And I guess along that whole line of data and how do you start to really represent things, Misty, I had a question for you. Part of the concept talks about really understanding risks, but today we don't understand necessarily how to quantify and weigh those risks. I was wondering if you could share your thoughts on how we move forward to do the things that, as Kyle mentioned, people do intuitively. How do we bring those into a computing environment?
So uncertainty and risk quantification, those are, you know, hot topics that are both scientific and honestly philosophical, right? So there are some things we know how to do right now. So, you know, if you give us enough sensors, right, we can analyze those sensors, we can test them, we can come up with really, really, really great predictions about how accurate a particular sensor is likely to be. Given enough data, we can just pin that down. I mean, think about the chips that go into our computers now, for example, right? We know exactly, coming off the manufacturing line, how many of those are likely to be faulty, and we have ways to identify those very quickly. And understand also where we need lots of redundancy, right? There's a reason why we have more than one pitot tube on an aircraft, right? We understand the likely failure rates and the ways that pitot tubes fail now. And so we start to understand how we can get what we need in a redundant fashion. That's one kind of uncertainty and risk analysis. And if you look at, you know, current day hazards, you know, the commercial aviation safety team, the unmanned aviation safety team, those teams have a pretty good handle on known risks and known hazards in the airspace. But you're absolutely right that, you know, the difficult thing to replace right now that human safety folks and aviation do so well are the more complex failures and uncertainties that happen just because of chaos, right? Just because of the small changes that happen up front. Weather is very, you know, that's the classic example, right? You can. We get better and better at weather all the time, but as you can ask the folks in Louisiana right now who are in the cone of uncertainty, right? There's a big difference between where that, you know, that eye of that hurricane actually makes landfall, and just how big and how powerful it is when it does so. And unfortunately, that's the best we can do there is to have ranges, right? And if you look, certainly in weather and other places, we're starting to get a lot better at having models that say, here's the range of possibilities that I think might happen today. So you know, that's another example of uncertainty. And then, you know, one of the things that keeps us up at night sitting in the safety project at NASA is the unknown unknowns. And the truth is that people are not great at really understanding what those risks are. And this is a place where the machines might help us a lot, right? Certainly there are times when I, as a parent or as a driver or in any of the many dangerous things that I wake up in the morning and do every day, something will strike me and I'll go, huh, that's funny. That's odd. I wonder if that's a thing I should worry about or not. And honestly, as people, we don't always make the best decisions whenever we're introduced to new situations that we haven't seen as hazards before. And that's a place I think where the machines really can help us, especially as they start to aggregate over many, many flights and many, many organizations. They can start to say, oh, no, this is a thing we've seen before. It happens because of this. Or, you know, what I'm more excited about is whenever the machines can go, you know what, this thing is different and I don't know why, and I need some safety experts to come look at it right now and tell me why. And I think that's a place we can start to make a difference today in today's operations. And it's a place we're trying to make a difference. And I'm really excited about some of the initial work we've got going with our partners.
Yeah, I think that's really a fascinating area, especially looking at the question of how do you address risk in a smart way? And how do you address maybe that there are different levels of acceptable risk, depending on the urgency of what's happening, the kind of mission. And so it's, you've really got a lot of factors that you have to weave all together to come up with a good approach. And, you know, along with understanding these factors, I had a question for Lance. And this is related to really understanding that entire safety picture. And so recently, the Flight Safety Foundation highlighted the work in a concept called learning from all operations. This seems to have a lot of intersection with the whole concept of IASMS. And I was wondering if you could share your thoughts on that.
Thank you. It's a good question. So the Flight Safety Foundation, they held the Learning from All Operations event, and that was focused on understanding and promoting globally the practical implementation of the concepts of system safety thinking and how to better utilize and communicate safety data more effectively. And the NASA System-Wide Safety Project participated in that September event and to describe NASA research teams that are exploring multifaceted, multidimensional approaches to how to integrate success factors, learning from what operators in the aviation system do well, and how to use that data to improve safety, as well as overcoming barriers to provide in-time safety assurance to enable a more agile, robust, responsive, flexible, resilient safety management system that can scale to future aviation needs and new emerging concepts of operations, such as urban air mobility and advanced aerial mobility.
Thank you. To John, one of the things I thought was really interesting is you also have a background in the commercial aviation area as well, research for NASA. And one of the things I'm wondering about is, are we going to have any kind of evolution of roles between government and industry players? Might there be any roles that are traditionally done by government now that you anticipate will change under IASMS?
That's a great question, Debbie. And if I had the answer, we'd be a lot further along than we are right now. But yeah, I think certainly there's a possibility that those kinds of roles will change. It seems clear to me that the FAA will always have a regulatory role that they'll continue to have. But questions, for example, I mean, you think about the kinds of things that Misty and Kyle and Lance just mentioned. If we start talking about taking capabilities from humans and putting them in the hands of machines, number one, it's probably a pretty good idea for us to understand exactly what it is the humans do that they're good at, which is what Lance just mentioned. You think about safety too, as opposed to, you know, traditional safety. We're going to have to figure out new ways to certify these kinds of systems. You know, if you've got a system with a machine learning enabled component in it, just as a very first start, how are we going to do that? Do the processes that we have in place that have worked historically pretty well for us in certifying and assuring the safety of components and systems within an aircraft don't work very well? And so one of the things we're having to do is we're trying to develop a prototype system and process by which someone could certify a component, something with a machine learning enabled component in it. As Kyle mentioned much earlier during the slide presentation, you think about some of the supplemental data service providers, or I think the most recent acronym now is PSU, is provider of services for UAS or UAM. You know, some of those things are going to be, I suspect, in the hands of the government. Some of them will be in the hands perhaps an entity that manages a small portion of airspace, and that entity has a relationship with the government or approval by the government to manage that particular part of airspace. And there will be other providers of services that some people might decide they don't want. Others will decide that it's worth the investment to get that information from them because of the particular mission that they have. And so I think a lot of that is really wide open right now. And part of our research, we hope, will be to uncover to put some of those functions.
One of the things in particular that boggles my mind is the sheer data volume. You know, I think Kyle mentioned maybe an order of magnitude more of some of these new air operations. And I can't imagine that our traditional approach of collecting aviation safety data can survive under that different model.
Yeah, I agree completely. Something's got to change. You know, in whose hands it will ultimately lie, who knows? But it's the way and the manner by which we gather that information and process it, as Kyle mentioned, I think many times up front, it's just got to change.
Right. It also sounds like perhaps some of the decision-making approaches will change in terms of who is involved in making the decision about safety.
Indeed, absolutely.
Great. So I have one more question here, and this is for Kyle. And you mentioned already a number of venues where you wanted to invite folks. You mentioned the airlines, you mentioned business aviation, and the FAA research transition teams. Perhaps maybe this is addressed to some of the more non-traditional communities, but what are the next steps you'd like to see happen in terms of engaging with this much more broader aviation community, and in particular the UAS community, to help your concept mature?
Yeah, absolutely. We're at the beginning of developing some of these different concepts, and we're also very far along in different elements of it. But what we have before us is, like you pointed out earlier, if we're gonna increase the order of magnitude of operations that we have, by an order of magnitude, we really need to be informed by all parties, right? And I think that's gonna be really essential to getting the right information, because depending on the operation that you have envisioned for your particular niche of the world, you're going to encounter different sets of risks and hazards that are there. And all these different operations are going to be happening in the same airspace, right? So I think a big part of this is informing what we already know exists today from traditional airspace operations that we have today. And seeing what the world looks like, trying to, you know, see forward into the future, you know, how all these different things will interact with each other. And so it's a lot of just ideating and visioning efforts that go into this. And so that's why these, like, and Misty mentioned, the AAM ecosystem working groups is really just getting together to say, hey, this is what my corner of the world looks like, right? This is what's important to me, right? And I want to be able to have access to the airspace and participate in the airspace. And I think if you look at the regulator side of this, right, what the FAA and their counterparts across the world look like, they look at the airspace and they say, I'm charged with regulating my corner of the world to say, I need to make this fair and equitable, you know, for people that want to participate in this. And if you look at the way the industry is right now, that can be a burdensome charge to manage, especially as you have new entrants coming into it. And so that's why I think engaging with the small UAS, the large UAS, the UAM industry, there's a large number of new entities there that are trying to break into this at various levels, whether they're, like John mentioned, PSU type service providers, supplemental data service providers, which if, in my estimation, and I know several others, is going to be a multi-billion dollar market just to be able to provide the supplemental data that's needed to drive these systems. We just need to see what's in the realm of possible to figure out how we manage, like we've pointed out many times, the known unknowns and the unknown unknowns that comes from the chaos of all these things flying in a mixed airspace. And so that's, like I said, we need to protect the existing transportation system that's there, because that is, you know, a cornerstone to our society that we have right now. I love being able to fly home. I live on the East Coast. I fly to Iowa all the time. I fly all over for different meetings and things, and hopefully post-COVID, we'll all be able to get back to that world that we have here. But I also, you know, with new markets, we need to be able to figure out how to do all that safely, because I like the proposal of being able to take my car and, you know, skip some traffic and things like this. That vision of the future solves a lot of problems for me, so I want to see that be realized, but I don't want that to disrupt the things that I already have. So that's why just taking stock of everybody's desires for what they envision their operation to look like needs to be a part of the discussion. And so I think, like we said, that AAM ecosystem working groups is a great way. You can also just reach out to us directly. We partner with several different airlines that we have here already just to figure out a little finer grained detail of how they do things from a day-to-day basis, just so we aren't starting from scratch. So it's a lot coming together. Like you said, it's a lot of sometimes collaborating and sometimes competing factors that we have to figure out. So that's why getting everybody at the table is important.
Right. And that's where the nuance is how do you trade off between all these possible solutions? Where do you distribute things? How do you allocate functionality, mm-hmm. roles, and responsibility? I just want to mention, over this conversation, I've heard a lot of key themes. Just wanted to repeat, you know, the very first thing that we're going to be having new vehicles, new operations, and new concepts for how these operations are managed overall. I've heard discussions about privacy, and although we didn't mention it, there's certainly security involved in these. A lot of questions, how do we quantify risk and how do we integrate data in a way that appropriately allocates responsibility to different locations and distributes it as appropriate. So I just wanted to see, panelists, whether you had any other closing thoughts to share.
No, Debbie, I think you've summarized it well. Obviously, in the limited amount of time that we had, we couldn't cover all of the things we're working on or all the things we've thought about or even all of the things that keep us up at night. But yeah, you're absolutely right. And as we used to joke about in a previous life, when someone would say, well, I'm going to optimize this, the joke was around what? And I'll just say, I've never been in a job where that question was bigger, you know, to try to figure out what, you know, you've got so many competing success criteria that all of those exercises to balance those things, you know, appropriately and fairly and adequately is that's a big part of the job. And we just want to thank you for the opportunity to come and chat and thank the audience for listening in. We hope you'll be excited and maybe figure out a way to be a part of it.
Yep, thank you so much. And I do encourage anyone who's going to be viewing this video to reach out to the NASA team. This is really an opportunity to be at the ground floor, I think, to make some exciting new concepts happen. Thank you very much, everyone. And I appreciate the time you spent with us. And I look forward to seeing you all again.
Thank you, Debbie.
Thank you.
Thank you.